not take this lightly. I'd like to give honor to your pastor and honor to my pastor as well, Pastor Tarr, all the way from good old East Dixfield, Maine. He entrusted me to represent our church with whatever dignity I can seem to find. So with the help of God, I'm going to go ahead and preach what God has placed upon my heart. Without any further ado, directing your attention to the word of the Lord, Genesis chapter number 37, beginning in verse number 1. I got to warn you, I am a machine gun of a preacher. I start and I do not stop until the job is done. So fasten your seatbelts and we'll go with it. Thank you. Give you a few moments to get there. And then after that, you're on your own. Praise God. When you got it, say amen. The Bible reads in verse number 1, "And Jacob dwelt in the land wherein his father was a stranger, in the land of Canaan. These are the generations of Jacob. Joseph, being 17 years old, was feeding the flock with his brethren. And the lad was with the sons of Bilhah and with the sons of Zilpah, his father's wives. And Joseph brought unto his father their evil report. Now Israel loved Joseph more than all his children, because he was the son of his old age. And he made him a coat of many colors. And when his brethren saw that their father loved him more than all his brethren, they hated him and could not speak peaceably unto him. And Joseph dreamed a dream, and he told it his brethren, and they hated him yet the more. And he said unto them, Hear, I pray you, this dream which I have dreamed." I want to preach to you for a short time tonight, if I could, on simply, my dream will not die. My dream will not die. Let's pray. Lord God, I thank you, Jesus, for another day, for another opportunity, God, to be able to come into this precious place. God, I thank you, God, for all that you have done and all that you are going to do. I pray, God, that your anointing would be upon me, for without you, I can do nothing, my Lord. I pray, God, that you'd give me the words to speak unto your people. Let me be a blessing and not a curse. And I give you all the honor, all the glory, all the praise and worship and thanksgiving in the all-powerful name of Jesus Christ. I pray and claim these things. Before you're seated, give the Lord a hand clap of praise and give him a shout with a voice of triumph. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. You may be seated in Jesus' name. Now, I'm pretty sure most of you, if not all of you, could probably tell the story of Joseph. But just in case you can't, I'm going to tell it to you. We know that Joseph was the son of his father's old age. And for this reason, his father made him a coat of many colors and displayed it amongst his brethren. And this caused his brothers to be quite hateful towards him. This caused his brethren to just despise him. Joseph, if you read the Bible, was a little snitch. He would tell his father of all the evil things in which his brethren were doing, and they hated him. And then one night, God gives Joseph a dream. Here you go, Joseph. Here's the dream. If you read the story, you know the 12 brothers have their sheaves of wheat, and those 12 sheaves of wheat bow down to Joseph's wheat. And then the 12 stars and sun and moon also bow down to Joseph. And here's Joseph. What tenacity. What audacity for this young man to go to his brother and say, "Hey, guess what? You're going to bow to me one day." Think about that. His brothers already hated him, but he said, "God gave me a dream, and you're going to bow to me." And the Bible says that they hated him all the more. So the story goes on. His brethren are quite displeased with him, so they plot against him. They sell him into slavery to the Ishmaelites for the price of a slave. They take the blood of a lamb and they splatter it on the Joseph's coat and gives it to the father and says, "Too bad, so sad, Pops. Your favorite born is no longer with us." And Israel thinks his son is long gone and dead, and you know Joseph is in slavery. He moves on, and you know the story. He gets bought by Potiphar, and Potiphar realized there was something special about this boy. Everything that this young man touched, God seemed to bless. And Potiphar didn't say the gods of Egypt seemed to bless it. Potiphar understood the God that Joseph served was the one blessing his household. So Potiphar said, "Joseph, guess what? You're getting a promotion. You're in charge over all my household. Congratulations. Whether you like it or not, that's the deal." So Joseph is going on his way, doing all that his master is asking him to do, trusting God, holding on to his integrity. And here comes Mrs. Goo Goo Eyes, Potiphar's wife, and she tries to have an affair with Joseph, and Joseph has integrity and said, "I'm not going to sin against my God." And for his integrity, he got tossed in jail. How do you like that? You stand up for what's right, and he got tossed in jail. Now, the Bible does not make it clear how long Joseph was in the prison cell. I don't know. But all I know is while he was there, he got another promotion. The jailer said, hey, everything this guy touches seems to be blessed. Here's a promotion, Joseph. You're now in charge of the jail. Not much of a promotion, but hey, what can you do about it? And the Bible lets us know that there's two individuals that approach Joseph and say, hey, Joseph, we know that you are one with God. This would entitle that Joseph was there for some time. He was able to develop a friendship with other inmates there. And these two individuals, a former butler and a former baker, says, Joseph, we know that you are one with God and that you can interpret dreams. And Joseph says, all right, tell me your dreams. And the butler says, all righty, I was out and I picked grapes from three vines. I squeezed the juice of the grapes into a cup and I gave it to Pharaoh. And the baker says, you ain't got nothing on my dream, brother. Here you go. I was out with three baskets of bread, and out of nowhere, these rats with wings came out of everywhere and just started attacking me, biting me, and they ate all my bread. And Joseph says, all right, butler, in 3 days, you're going to be restored your position. Congratulations. And the baker's probably going, all right. But guess what happened? Joseph said, baker, it's not the same for you. In 3 days, your head's going to roll. And it happened. And I don't mean to try to be funny. That's just my personality. But nonetheless, that's what happened. The butler was restored to his position, and the baker perished 3 days since Joseph told him. Now here's Joseph stuck in a prison cell. No access to the outside world. He's just sitting there with his dreams that God gave him. I can only imagine Joseph maybe had some bad days where he began to question God. I don't know. I'm just trying to think between the lines. But something tells me that he had to do everything within his power to hold on to those dreams that God gave him, despite how bleak and how dark the circumstance may be. And so the story goes on. Now it's time for Pharaoh to have his dreams. If you read the Bible, you will understand he had two dreams, one in which seven sick cows devoured seven healthy cows, and the second dream, seven sickly grains of stalk devoured and ate seven healthy grains of stalk. And Pharaoh's about ready to lose his mind. He's trying all of his magicians and his Java juice and anything that he can get a hold of to try to find out what these dreams mean. And after a long time goes on, the Bible says that the butler approached Pharaoh. It doesn't say that Pharaoh called him. And if you know any time, that time frame, you don't just go to your leader and say, hey, boss, I got a word for you. You usually are drawn, and something tells me that God moved upon that butler to go and tell Pharaoh, hey, Pharaoh, there's a man in your dungeons who can interpret dreams. He is one with God. And so Pharaoh decides, okay, I'm going to give this young man a chance. He brings Pharaoh in, and you know, Joseph interprets the dreams and says there's going to be 7 years good harvest. It's going to be a wonderful, plenteous season. It's going to be awesome. But it's going to be followed by 7 years of famine like the world has never seen. And Pharaoh says, oh me, oh my, what shall we do about this, Joseph? And Joseph says, select yourself a man who will harvest the plenty, who will take the harvest and save one-fifth of it and store it. So during the 7 years of hardship, we can survive. And Pharaoh's so excited, he says, Joseph, you're that man. Congratulations, you're getting a promotion. You're second in command. Here's the ring. Here's the seal. Do all that you've said. And you know that eventually Joseph's dreams were fulfilled when his brothers came from Canaan, and they asked for the food, and Joseph tells them what you meant for evil, God meant for good. They bowed, and Joseph's dreams were fulfilled. That's my foundation. Now I'm going to preach to you. Joseph's biggest problem in his life in fulfilling his dreams was the people that he had to deal with. He had to deal with family members who hated him, a father who even rebuked him for his dreams, liars and cheaters and individuals who were up to no good. But you see, Joseph had a very rare ability. He had the potential to forgive those who did him wrong. What kept his dreams alive throughout all those years was the simple fact that he chose to forgive those who betrayed him. He chose to forgive those who stood in his way. He chose to forgive those that were his enemy. I'm here to tell you, ladies and gentlemen, I don't know what you've been through in your life. I don't know what you came into this place bearing, but whether you like it or not, you've got problems. Whether you like it or not, there are dilemmas for which you have no solution. There are problems for which you have no answers. There have been setbacks and disappointments, and there's been situations that you'd rather not talk about. And I'm here to tell you there will always be Hamans who try to cut you down at the knees to try to bend you to their own will. There will always be Jezebels who will try to intimidate you, making you think that God's forgotten about you. There will always be Delilahs who will try to get you to compromise your source of strength. There will always be Demases who will forsake you and abandon you. There will always be Sauls who will be jealous of your anointing. And there will always be Rabashaks who will trash talk you while you're trying to do the very work of God. But if there's anything to you at all, you've got to learn to build an altar and forgive those who have stood in your way. Somewhere along the way, you've got to get your mind made up that I'm serving Jesus regardless of my circumstances, regardless of those who have stood in my way. I'm going all the way. You know, the Bible says, trust in the Lord with all thine heart and lean not into thine own understanding. You want to know why? Because your own understanding will try to justify hating those who've done you wrong. Your own understanding will try to justify quitting, will try to justify throwing in the towel. That's why the Bible says don't lean to your own understanding, but rather trust in God. Is it always easy to forgive? No, it ain't. Believe me, I know from personal experience, it ain't easy to forgive. Is it easy sometimes to become hateful and spiteful? Absolutely. Is it easy sometimes to look at your circumstances and say, I'm just going to throw in the towel and quit? Yeah, but I'm here to tell you, if you're ever going to achieve and fulfill your dreams, you're going to have to learn to forgive. One very important fact about Joseph's dreams is that there were individuals hanging in the balance. They were depending on his dreams to be fulfilled, whether they knew it or not. You see, if Joseph failed to accomplish that which God called him to do, Egypt would have failed. The outlying countries that they depended on Egypt during the hardship time, they all would have died of starvation. But because one man stood in the gap, hear me, ladies and gentlemen, there are souls hanging in the balance. They are depending on you to fulfill that which God has called you to do. This ain't just about you, but this is about this dying world. And I'm here to tell you, a dying world cannot afford a dying church. We've got to hold on to the vision. The Bible says the people without the vision perish. But I'm here to tell you, if you can never get beyond your circumstances, you've already lost. I'm here to tell you, if you allow yourself to be held hostage by people, by circumstances, you're never going to see the fulfillment of your dream. You're never, and I'm not talking about some worldly dream. I'm talking about a dream that comes straight from the throne of glory. I'm talking about something that God gave you, whether it's calling you to be an evangelist or preacher, whatever it may be. God is counting on you to reach them. But how can you reach them unless you first learn to forgive? I'm here to tell you, we all want to sit there and say, I love you, Jesus, and I want to be just like you, Lord. I want to serve you, Jesus, with all my heart. Do you really want to be like him? It's easy to say so when the miracles are being poured out. It's easy to say so when the blind eyes are being opened and the deaf ears are being unstopped and the dumb are beginning to speak. It's easy to talk about wanting to be like Jesus when the miraculous is happening. But what about the times when Jesus prayed alone? What about the times when he had to fast 40 days? What about the times when he healed people and they called him a blasphemer? What about the time that he touched people's lives and they said that he was in league with the devil? Read your Bible. They lied about him and they accused about him. What about the times where he bore a cross for you? What about the lonely times and the hard times? And those times, you don't see people so apt to saying, I want to be like Jesus. You see, everybody wants the wondrous things of God. But I'm here to tell you, it comes at a price. You see, everybody wants to dance on the grave of their enemy, but nobody wants to go to war anymore. Everybody wants to shout on the mountaintop, but nobody wants to endure the valley low. Everybody wants the revival, but nobody wants to build altars and present their own lives a living sacrifice unto God. Everybody wants the miraculous and the fulfillment of the dreams, but not everybody wants to forgive. And I've watched people throughout my life. They've come and they've gone. And I've always seen people bore down and bitter and broken because of what's happened to them in their life. And sometimes I've even heard people say, life ain't fair. But what I say to that is, I thank God life ain't fair. You want to know why? Because we as human beings like to use that phrase, life ain't fair, when it means we're going to acquire something of value to us. If Pastor Scott drives a Ferrari, I think it's only fair that I drive a Ferrari. If Brother Penrod has $1 billion in the bank, I only think it's fair that I have $1 billion as well. But if you really understand what that word fairness means, let me give it to you this way. Another word for fairness is judgment. Fairness simply means to acquire what one truly deserves. Think about that, ladies and gentlemen. Think about that for a moment, because I'm here to tell you there was nothing fair about Jesus manifesting himself in the flesh, having to go through hell and high water on the face of this earth, bearing your cross, bearing your sin, bearing your shame, being abused and brutalized for your salvation. There was nothing fair about that, but nonetheless, God said, I'm going to take fairness by the throat and I'm going to throw it aside, and instead, I'm going to give them my mercy. I'm going to give them my grace. I'm going to give them my blood. I'm going to give them my name. I'm going to give them my spirit. I'm going to give them dreams, and with my help, they're going to accomplish it. But to be Christ-like also means sometimes you've got to humble yourself and see if you can live in life what's been preached behind a pulpit. I believe me when I tell you, ladies and gentlemen, I know what it's like to bear hate for somebody. There was one point in my life where I could have killed somebody if I got the chance. But after a day and a half of festering with that hate, your insides begin to feel sick. I had to build an altar, Sister Hicks, and I had to get a hold of God and say, God, forgive me for that hate. And I did what I heard all my life, praying for your enemies. It ain't easy, but I said, God, save that individual nonetheless. And would you believe they got saved? They got back into church. And ladies and gentlemen, I'm not just talking about this from outside the box, but I've experienced it and I've lived it. And I'm here to tell you, you've got to learn to forgive. You want to know why Jesus' ministry was fulfilled? But some people don't realize this, but Joseph was a foreshadow of Jesus Christ. And Jesus Christ, the fact that his ministry was fulfilled was on the simple fact that he chose to forgive us rather than damn and condemn us. If there was anybody who ever had a right to spit in your face and trample you over and stomp you out, it was Jesus. But he said, I love them too much to throw them into the fire. I love them too much to let my creation be lost. And I'm here to tell you, the devil thought he had humanity. The devil had a grimace smile on his face on that day when crucifixion was taking place. But I'm here to tell you, God Almighty rose that flesh up 3 days later, conquered hell, death, sin, and the grave. And I'm here to tell you, you have access to the very throne of God. The veil was torn in twain. It was ripped in two. And now you have access to all that God has in store. But I'm here to tell you, you're never going to do anything for God if you're harboring bitterness and you're harboring hate. You're never going to have unity in the church if people are hating one another. You're never going to be able to get anywhere with God until you do a little soul searching and saying, God, help me to forgive those who have done me wrong. It's not an easy prayer. It's not a fun prayer. But let me tell you something. The people that you forgive, they may not care about it. But when you forgive those individuals, you are liberating yourself to a higher calling. You are allowing yourself to see the fulfillment of all God wants you to be. You are allowing God's word to become alive in you. You are allowing God to breathe life upon you. You are allowing God to have his way. And only his way is going to get you to the finish line. I'm here to tell you, this life ain't fair, and this life is challenging, and this life is tough. Each and every one of us here could get up and tell a sob story, but I got news for you. I don't care if I show up to heaven's gates bloody, bruised, tattered, and torn. I at least want to be able to tell Jesus, I never quit. I some way, somehow continued to fight the good fight of faith. I wasn't perfect. Sometimes I fail. The Bible says, rejoice not against me, O my enemies, for when I fall. It doesn't say if I fall, but it says when I fall, I shall arise. You want to know why? Because there's a resurrecting power called the Holy Ghost that just won't let me die. God's brought me too far for me to be lost. God's brought me too far to let a little petty difference by somebody else to keep me from being saved. God's brought me too far from where I've started from. And above all else, I've got to be saved. Grandpa Walston used to tell us kids, he used to say, the greatest treasure that you can ever lay up in heaven is a soul. And I'm here to tell you, whether you like it or not, you've been called to be a soul winner. And the only way you're ever going to reach this lost and dying community, the only way you're ever going to be able to reach this lost and dying world, is if you can learn to forgive. You said, I don't like hearing that word, preacher. I don't care. I'm just the messenger. You don't like the message, take it up with management afterwards. But I've come to tell somebody today, I don't know who I'm reaching for. I don't know what's gone on in the past of your life. I don't know what you've had to endure. I don't know who's done what to you. But I'm here to tell you, if you stay in that prison cell of unforgiveness, if you stay in that place of bitterness, it will fester into hate. It will kill your soul. It will destroy your life. But I'm here to tell you, there's something so precious about the Holy Ghost. It can give you strength to forgive those who've done you wrong. It can reach into places where others can't reach. It can do things in your life that you've never thought possible. And only through God's Spirit, hear me somebody, only through the power of God's Spirit can you find the strength to forgive? I keep going back to it, but I've got to emphasize it. It is one of the hardest things that you will ever have to do in your life. But it's well worth it, folks. I don't know who I'm talking to today, but I've just come to tell somebody in these short few moments, do what Joseph did and forgive. He could have whacked his brothers off when they came into Egypt, but he didn't. He could have whacked Potiphar and his wife off, but he didn't. He had a lot of authority now after Pharaoh promoted him, but instead he forgave. And for that cause, millions were spared. I wonder how many souls are hanging in the balance outside these doors. I wonder how many people are depending on you that you don't even realize. And they're dying and they're hurting and they're thirsting for something real. This world ain't got nothing to offer and they're crying out for help. And you are the tool. You are the key. You are the fulfillment of the dream that God is going to use to reach them. But if you allow yourself to be held hostage, I'm here to tell you, there's going to be blood on your hands, not only yours, but for those that only God could use you to reach. Because believe me, there are some souls that only you can reach. There's some individuals that only you can reach. And they're crying out, but it's going to take an individual saying, God, I want to forgive. God, and sometimes it's not forgiving others, it might be forgiving yourself. But it comes a line where you've got to determine in your heart, soul, strength, and mind, I've got to forgive. Some way, somehow, I don't care if I've got to throw myself at an altar for an hour, 2 hours, 3 hours, I've got to forgive. I've got to get that bitterness and that brokenness out because God gave me a dream and I refuse to let that dream die. I'm here to tell you, ladies and gentlemen, God wants to use you. God's given each and every one of you a dream and he's called you to do great things for his honor, for his kingdom, for his glory. But he will not force you. Sometimes I wish to God I can force people. I see the potential. I see how God wants to use some individuals, but they just sit there and they die in this. I implore you, ladies and gentlemen, find an altar. I implore you, do some soul searching. I implore you, forgive. Because if you can't forgive, you're never going to make it there. You're never going to see the fulfillment of those dreams. You're not going to experience all that God has in store for you. I'm not saying that you've got to let people take advantage of you or abuse you or hurt you. That's not what I'm saying. What I'm saying is simply forgive them and let God take care of the rest. I'm almost done. I told you I'm a machine gun of a preacher. Can we all stand as the musicians come? I don't want to keep you very long. This is what God impressed upon me. Don't let your dream die. Don't let your calling die. Don't let your ministry die. Don't let your communities die. Don't let this church die, but rather find an altar and forgive. Just forgive. You say we want to be like Jesus. Well, that's part of the process. So many times we want to jump to the end result, but God is putting his hand up and saying, hold on a second, I've got to do some cleaning here. I've got to purge you of a few things. I need you to allow me in so I can take care of a few issues that you buried away from everybody since you were a child or a teenager or an adult. How many years? I don't know. But God wants to do some cleaning. God wants to teach you that there is power in forgiveness. But you've got to let him. I wish I could pray the prayer for you, but I can't. I wish I could sometimes carry that cross for you, but I can't. I got my own to bear. Jesus looked at his disciples and said, carry your cross, lest you are none of mine. And part of that cross is forgiving. People are going to betray you. Jesus went as far to say, they hate me. What do you think they're going to do to you? Jesus made it clear there would be trials and there would be tribulation. There would be setbacks and there would be disappointments. But through it all, God gave us some other promises. That he would never leave us nor forsake us. That we could be confident in this very thing, that he which began a good work in us shall perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. The Bible lets us know greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. The Bible says I can do all things through Jesus Christ who gives me strength. What then shall we say to these things? If God be for us, then who can be against us? The Bible says with God all things are possible. You're saying, preacher, I just can't forgive them. I just can't get over this hurdle. With God, all things are possible. Preacher, you just don't know my past. I don't have to know it. He does. I don't have to know what you're going through. He sees you every step of the way. You're saying, preacher, you just don't know. I don't have to know. His blood paid the price. His spirit is great enough to bring you out. I'm trying to reach for somebody right now. I'm trying to reach for somebody. You've been bored down and buried for too long. underneath the dark abyss of your regrets and your past and your failures. I'm here to tell you the Bible lets us know that with God, all things are possible. I'm here to tell somebody, I'm going to shut up in a few seconds. I feel like telling somebody right now, if you can just forgive, your life is going to change in ways that you never thought possible. It's going to open avenues and doors for you that you never thought possible. And God's going to be the author and finisher of your faith. He's going to be the orchestrator. No longer your bitterness, no longer your brokenness, no longer your hate and anger, no longer your setbacks and disappointments. But rather, the King of all kings and the Lord of all lords is going to be orchestrating what's going on in your life. If you could just let go, forgive, and just let God. Don't allow a lying devil to convince you that you should just harbor those feelings. Don't allow a lying devil or people in this world to convince you that all is lost. But listen to the voice that comes straight from glory. Listen to the voice of the one who created all things. Listen to Jesus and follow his example and forgive. These altars are open. I don't know who this was for, but I'm just reaching for somebody. It's time to let go of your past so you can have a future. As Pastor Scott preached, let go of the goat. Let go of it already. It's time. Jesus wants to move. These altars are open. God